So, there will be two talks first, and the first talk is by Ambra Nani.
Here I am.
Yeah, okay, so Ambra is there, and we will have this exciting title, Unveiling Dust Around the World Stars. Please start.
Okay, can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Good. Okay. Okay, thank you. And let just me put a timer. Okay, thank you. And thanks for giving me the possibility of talking today about dust around the wolf stars, in particular about the observational and theoretical constraint we can have and the relevance of it for infrared emission of spatially aerosol galaxies. I'm currently employed in the National Center for Nuclear Research in Warsaw under the Sonata BIS project, the DINGOL, of which I am the PI. So just to start off, I pointed out some relevant questions in the field, which I believe that should be addressed in the next years, and we have the possibility actually to address. So first of all, how efficient is dust production and how dust composition is changing as a function of the stellar parameters of the star? So for example, a critical role is attributed to the metallicity. How dust production is linked to stellar winds. So we have already seen how dust is important for the development of the mass loss and stellar winds, but we still don't know all the details of it. And related to this, which are the optical properties of dust grains? So this is fundamental not only to understand stellar winds, but also to study the spectral energy distribution of stars and in order to estimate their mass loss rate and their dust production rates. So related to this, we have also how wolf stars enrich the interstellar medium with metals and dust and how we can constrain this from observations. And finally, how wolf stars contributed to the infrared emission of galaxies. So we know that wolf stars are short-lived, but nevertheless, they are very luminous and can largely contribute to the infrared emission of galaxies depending on the age of the main stellar population. So this is the schematic representation of a circumstellar envelope. We already have seen this several times. Just to remind you that we have two spectral types depending on the critical parameter C over ratio. So in cases less than one, we talk about oxygen-rich stars. In cases greater than one, we have carbon-rich stars. And starting from this, we can form different molecules and different dust in the circumstellar envelope. And once this happens, we can have the dust-driven wind. So just to start with oxygen-rich stars, so people have been looking at the spectra of these objects, and we find different spectral features that are evolving with the stellar parameters. In particular, here we have increasing mass loss rate of the star. So we clearly see for low mass loss rate, the corundum feature, the corundum bump here around 12 microns, and some silicate feature that are nevertheless not so prominent. But this silicate feature really becomes important and prominent as the mass loss rate increases. And so we have to interpret this picture why we have the corundum bump for low mass loss rate, while the corundum feature is completely disappearing for high mass loss rate. So there are different interpretations. So we can have that at low mass loss rate, we just form corundum and a small amount of silicates, and we may have been forming it as separate species. And for higher mass loss rate, we can have that silicates are formed in larger amounts, and therefore the silicate feature is dominating in the spectra and washing out the corundum feature. Or we can also have that corundum can act as seed nuclei for silicate grains at the highest mass loss rate. What we know is that these dust pieces are roughly proportional to the initial metallicity of the star, and as a consequence, also the wind speed is roughly proportional to is expected to be proportional to the metallicity because this is related to the silicate production, which are driving the wind. So people have been looking the infrared spectra also for carbon stars, of course. And in particular, there are studies related to understand how the features in carbon-rich stars are changing with the stellar parameters. For example, we have here the SiC silicon carbide feature emission strength over the continuum as a function of this color that proves the dust production rate. So for the Cindos production rate, we tend to have higher, a stronger SIC feature with respect to the lowest metallicity. And also by looking at the magnesium sulfide feature as well, the magnesium sulfide bump at 30 microns, people have tried to understand how dust grains are formed. And in particular, here we have two scenarios for the metal-rich and the metal-poor carbon stars. But nevertheless, the situation is more complicated because since we see SIC in absorption here, this means that also we need some silicon carbide at the surface of the grain. So of course, people are still working on that. Also, what is important to notice is that in the case of carbon stars, not all the dust pieces produced are just proportional to the metallicity. We have that amorphous carbon dust is expected to be proportional to the carbon excess, as well as acetylene molecules that are believed to be the building block of amorphous carbon. And this is because we have the third ridge up, so this is going to change as a function of the initial metallicity and of the mass of the star. So people have been looking also at the acetylene 7.5 microns equivalent width as a function always of the dust production rate of the stars. And so if we focus for a given dust production rate, we notice that the typical equivalent width is increasing for lower metallicity. So as we go from the Milky Way to the SMC. And actually this error bar that you see here is the scatter of the data. So it's not the error bar of the single observation. We have many more observations and points in this plot, but just to highlight the trend, the outer average for different beings in color. And here we have the scatter. So we try to interpret these observations. And recently we ran some simulation for different metallicity. So we took a prescription for dust growing wind dynamics and we coupled it with the Frutti evolutionary tracks. And we computed this for different metallicity and some different initial stellar masses. And here we have the acetylene injection rate as a function of the tau, the optical depth at 1 micron, which is proving essentially the dust production rate. And we clearly see that for lower metallicity, we have an increase of the acetylene content. And we interpreted this as an effect of the third ridge up. So we bring up more carbon, which produces acetylene molecules, but also is producing more carbon. But the main point here is that even if we produce more carbon, we still see an increase in the acetylene content because of the fact that the carbon dust produced at one point is halted because carbon is accelerating the outflow. And so at that moment, we just drop the density of the envelope and we stop forming carbon dust. We did this also for the three solar masses and the differences, we find a similar trend and the differences we have in the absolute value can maybe explain the scatter we have in these observations. So we also can look at the expansion velocity of carbon stars. Unfortunately, we don't have many measurements at subsolar metallicities. And so the ones we have indicate that probably there could be some, we could have some still some trend with the metallicity. And in particular, the expansion velocity tend to be lower for lower metallicity. However, this seems to create a tension with the theoretical understanding that we have. And here I put this plot showing how the wind speed is expecting to increase with the carbon excess. So why there is a tension? Because at lower metallicity, we expect the dredge up to be more efficient and to have larger carbon excess. And so we theoretically believed that we should see an increase in the expansion velocity of the stars. However, this tension, I believe that can be reconciled and maybe just apparent because in this plot in the right, we only consider an increase in the carbon excess. Why we should really follow what happens in the during the stellar evolution and what happens as a function of the metallicity. So this is what we try to do. And here I'm showing this plot with the expansion velocity as a function of the luminosity for different stellar luminosity, for different metallicity from the solar one to the Magellanic Cloud to the galactic halo. So we are decreasing the metallicity. And actually we found two different regimes depending on the initial mass of the star. So for stellar masses equal or below about two solar masses, we have that actually the wind speed increases with decreasing metallicity as you can see from these panels. And so this is kind of in agreement with hydrodynamic simulation that I showed you before, because the driving mechanism for accelerating the wind relies in the third dredge up. So we have more dredge up, we have more carbon at the surface, we produce more carbon, and we accelerate more efficiently. On the other hand, we have a different trend for the three solar mass stars, because we see that the expansion velocity tend to decrease with the metallicity. Why is so? It's so because it's true that the dredge up is still more efficient as the metallicity decreases, but on the other hand, we are increasing the effective temperature of our star, and so we are creating dust less efficiently. So we still have an effective third dredge up, but the driver of what drives this trend is basically the fact that the stars become hotter at lower metallicities. So this was the main point, and just to mention, so I will not enter the details of this, but just to tell you that this kind of constraint can be exist and can be derived. And in particular, this is related to the dust properties of amorphous carbon around carbon-rich stars. So basically the main goal of this work was to constrain the optical properties that best reproduce the spectral energy distribution and the photometry of the carbon stars in the Magellanic clouds. So this means to constrain the typical grain size together with the optical data set that are available in the literature and which are many for carbon stars. So if you want to know more, just please ask me. And basically what I didn't mention here is that the trick here is to compare the observation with the simulation, and through this we can get these constraints. So this is also very relevant for the estimate of the dust production rate, besides having to choose the optical constant in order to model the radiative transfer in the circumstellar envelope. But sometimes if we don't use consistent model, we need to estimate as well the expansion velocity of the envelope and the gas to dust ratio. We have seen this in Sophia Ramstedt talk. And this, if we look in the literature, we can find different estimates of the dust production rate for all the whole population of evolved stars in the SMC and the LMC. And depending on what you are selecting for your model, you get a variation up to a factor 5. However, even in some cases, depending how you estimate the injection rate from evolved stars, even in the most optimistic case, so in case you produce a lot of dust, evolved stars may not quickly reach the interstellar medium with dust, so not quickly enough to explain the amount of dust we observe today in these galaxies in the interstellar medium. And so people have been arguing that we need either type 2 supernova to replenish the interstellar medium and or dust growing the interstellar medium to build up the grain from the available metals. So people have also been looking to the total dust production rate in low metallicity dwarf galaxies. This is the total dust production rate divided by the total stellar mass in the system. So this is kind of specific dust production rate. And is in a wide range of metallicity, as you can see. And we are down to metallicity much lower than the SMC one order of magnitude. And as we can see, the specific dust production rate is rather constant with the metallicity. There is not a very large variation. And this is because the interstellar medium, the bulk of the population of the Wolf stars in this case, comes from carbon-rich stars. So in these star-forming low-metallicity galaxies, we have some carbon stars of 2-3 solar masses that are reaching the interstellar medium with carbon. And we can compare this with the measurement of the dust content in the ISM of these galaxies. And in particular, here we have the gas to dust ratio as a function of the metallicity. If people have been finding that actually the trend is not flat, but there is a clear dependence between the dust to gas ratio and the metallicity, which seems not to reflect what we found for the dust production rate of AGD stars. And there are some explanations maybe about that. So evolved star may be not the main contribution of dust in the ISM of these galaxies. Maybe supernova, type 2 supernova may be the most important source, or dust from AGB stars may be destroyed later and reprocessed in the interstellar medium so that we don't have this flat behavior here. And in this last slides, I have another couple of slides. I would just to try to convey the message about the importance of modeling circumstellar dust for stellar population, and in particular to model the mid-infrared emission in galaxies. Here what we see is the integrated flux of all the stellar population, which different stellar ages here plotted with different colors and for two choices of the metallicity. Here in black, you see the case in which no dust is considered. So you see that in case we have no dust in the circumstellar envelope of these stars, we do not get any prominent infrared feature from the stellar population, but as soon as we include the dust, and of course we this will depend on the age of the stellar population and on the metallicity, but in some cases we can get a very prominent infrared feature. And so this is mainly the message that I want to convey. So the importance of modeling dust around the evolved stars in the local universe and to understand the trends of the feature with the stellar parameters in order also to model the mid-infrared emission of galaxies. And people have also tried to estimate what is the contribution in the infrared from evolved stars for the Magellanic clouds. Around 3-4 microns, they found that a very large amount of the flux is from evolved stars, both for the LMC and for the SMC. On the other hand, around 8 microns, we can either be dominated by the PIH's emission, or we can still have some considerable fraction of light from the evolved stars. And this is pretty
important. 2 minutes. 2 minutes.
Oh, 2 minutes. Okay. Okay. So I thought I have less time actually, but fine. So I'm almost done. So I would say this is good. So this is pretty important actually in the context of modeling the panchromatic view, especially on resolved galaxies. So when we have all the spectral energy distribution of spatially resolved galaxies. And in particular, this is relevant when we have those cases in which actually the PIH emission is not that prominent. And so evolved stars can really contribute to the mid-infrared emission, of course, if we have a fraction of the stellar population that have the right age. And since this is mainly one of the goals of the Dingle project, so to model the mid-infrared consistently and then to apply this modeling to the study of spatially unresolved galaxies. So I leave you with my conclusion. So we can hope to derive some constraints about dust composition and condensation sequence around I put the TPHB stars, but evolved stars in general by study the infrared spectra. The wind speed of the outflow will depend on the dust condenser, but of course for carbon-rich stars, we have the problem that we have only few observations at metallicity lower than solar. So the estimate that actually we have on the dust production rate and mass loss rate for evolved stars in spatially resolved galaxies are affected by the assumption that we made. And of course, this can lead to different results. Okay, and so it's important to constrain, for example, the optical properties and rely on good modeling. And this is essential, of course, for modeling the spatially resolved galaxies, especially in the mid-infrared bands. And that's all.
Thank you, Ambra. Okay. So